This is a National Arts Center podcast.
Welcome to NEC Dance with Kathy Levy. In this podcast, guest host Lindsay Lachance of the National Arts Center's Indigenous Theatre Department chats with Margaret and Andrew Grenier of Dancers of Damelahamid a few days before its NEC debut and world premiere of Mînowin, a contemporary dance work that looks at what emerges from the great loss and imbalance of the past.
Thank you so much for coming in this morning, Margaret and Andrew. I'm really excited that we get to spend some time together talking about your amazing work. So maybe to begin, you could both introduce yourselves to the listeners.
Oh, thank you. I'm Al Tansi. My name is Margaret Grenier. I'm the executive and artistic director with Dancers of Damelahamid, and I'm also the festival director for the Coastal Dance Festival. And we're really happy to be here and going to be sharing Mînowin as its premiere next week.
And I'm Andrew Grenier, and I'm the creative producer for Dancers of Damelahamid, and really excited to be here at the launch of Indigenous Theatre. So thank you for having us as part of your program.
Thank you for being here. We are so, so happy to have you both and everyone in the company here. So speaking about dance and thinking about dance, I've heard you speak before, Margaret, about how you've been dancing from a very young age. And I'm just wondering if you would like to start to locate yourself in your dance practice.
I am very privileged that I had the opportunity to grow up with dance, and I grew up in the communities along the Skeena River, which is our Gitxsan, our River of Mists, and I was the first generation to grow up in that way. The previous generation was part of the process of revitalization of dance after the potlatch ban, but because of the work that they did, even to my earliest memory, I was growing up immersed in the dance practice of our family's lineage, and also within the communities of the Gitxsan and the Tsimshian and the other neighboring communities, and just being really exposed to a lot of the artwork that had taken place at that time.
That's amazing. And so your family is involved in founding Dancers of Damelahamid, the company that you are both currently running. And so is there a parallel between the revitalization of your community's dance practices into the founding of this dance company?
Yes. I think that when I was a young person, I never fully understood what had taken place with the work of my parents' generation and the guidance that they had under my grandmother. But in looking back at it, it was an amazing thing that they did. And it was really an artistic risk that I didn't fully comprehend, because prior to the potlatch ban, everything had been shared within our feast halls. So even to bring dance into the performance space was a very big step and a really transformative one. And if it wasn't for that decision, I wouldn't have been immersed in dance in the way that I had been. And so once I came to realize that, it really made me aware of the importance that each generation has in continuing the practice. And we each have our own challenges, we each have our own personal mandate that drives us. And for me, having the foundational knowledge of their work is what compels me. I want to be able to leave that for those that will follow. But I think it's also really important that each generation tells their stories, and that's what we are doing with the work that we're doing now. I don't think you can ever achieve what you're meant to achieve if you are trying to replicate what has already taken place. I think you have to navigate and find your own way.
Absolutely. And currently, still in your company, you have an intergenerational company. So you still work with your family members, is that right?
Yes.
Yes, we have two grandchildren coming.
Yay!
Which is going to be exciting for us.
Yes. Yes, and it's really a nice time as well, because I'm still dancing, and our son and daughter, Nigel Grenier and Raven Grenier, are now old enough that they're really taking on a mature role within the practice. And my mother, Elder Margaret Harris, is still with us, and so yes, we are able to work in a way where it's connecting through the generations. You know, having someone to guide and mentor us, but also being able to form and shape by working so connectedly with our children, and yes, now our grandchildren.
That's so fantastic. And there's also Indigenous folks in the dance company that are from different communities and different geographical backgrounds and experiences. So what's it like to have a bunch of different Indigenous cultural practices come together to make and to perform dances together?
I think that for the Dancers of Damelahamid, I grew up in a really strong tradition of family practice, and it always has been a practice. It's something that you dedicate your life to. It's not just something that you do when you're in rehearsal or when you're working on a project. It's part of everything, and it's interconnected to everything. And that is the way that we have trained and just built up the knowledge within our children as well. And I think that when we have other artists that work with us, they're brought into something in a much different way than they would be if they were working on a project, or if they were, you know, coming to dance with us in a way that was really focused on a short period of time. And so when
or it's in a collective.
Yes.
It's a family, not a collective, in the sense that they're coming into a family as opposed to bringing their, I mean, people always bring themselves to the table, but they're very much being adopted into Dancers of Damelahamid.
And that becomes something that sort of extends beyond in terms of the training that they will receive from being part of our company, and then also just the long-term relationships that are built through that. And I think that is a reflection. Like, that is a reflection of not only the work that we do now, but even the work that was done in the 1960s, where we collectively in the same way found a way to move forward. And it's my strong opinion that there needs to be a way to look at things inclusively. I think that only strengthens who we are.
Absolutely. And it definitely embodies ideas around kinship and relationship building, and really expanding and adopting people in, as you said, is so, so important and significant to think about when people come together to make art and to make offers to public. So I think it's really awesome. And do you have a particular process for working with cultural practices or traditions or languages or songs that are particular to family or community, and then performing or sharing them to the public?
Well, up until my father passed, the artists that were invited in were under the guidance and leadership that he had the authority over within the practice and with the family. And so as part of the process that we have carried forward with that has been working from the vocabulary, the training, and you know, referencing what we know to be what has defined us as who we are. But in terms of working with other artists, it is it's very much navigating through created choreography and created song composition that doesn't really cross that line. And that is something that I think is very much part of the practices on the Northwest Coast, because there is something to be really carefully navigated when you have a song and dance that has its place within hereditary lineage, and then you also have work that's coming from a contemporary perspective where it's being composed. There needs to be an understanding there of the values and the way of understanding that's integral to the work. But then there's also a way to work through it so that you're not infringing on anything else at the same time.
And a big part of that process is the cultural consultants that we have, our elders, our Margaret's mom, and elder Betsy Lomax and Lawrence Trache, who's Cree, and Betsy's Gitxsan, as well as other consultants like Terry Lynn Williams Davidson and other people that we are inspired by and look up to for guidance and demonstration of how to navigate mm-hmm. those pathways.
Yeah, because we're not the first company to work in the way of composing songs and creating new dances. And one of the mentors that we work with, David Boxley, his community was relocated in Metlakatla, and they went through a period where they completely lost song and dance. And at that time, there was a practice, we have a practice of lending songs and dances, and so that was something that my parents initiated at that time. And then through that, those songs became the first songs for a new generation to access dance. But then they've moved forward and created such an amazing breadth of work, song, dance, and visual arts. And so it's really important that we share within one another stories, because it's too hard of a journey to do on your own.
Right, absolutely. And it just sounds like it's another example of how to involve family and involve kinship relationships and trust and being accountable to the people that you work with by sharing and asking permission to use the songs and inviting people in. So it sounds great.
Yeah, and that relationship extends decades. It's not just people that have been brought on recently. David's been absolutely amazing, David Boxley, and taking in the whole family and, you know, training Nigel and Raven and myself and Margaret, and just in terms of the artistic rules and around the development of design, Northwest mm-hmm. Coast design. And we owe a lot to all of our elders for teaching us.
That's so awesome. Yeah. And the Coastal Dance Festival, is that predominantly built off of relationships that you have with other dance groups and other communities, or was there an impulse to start running that festival at the Museum of Anthropology?
So there was a predecessor to the Coastal Dance Festival that took place in Prince Rupert, and that went from like the 1960s up until the 1980s. And so we wanted to initiate a festival that really drew from the values of the festival that I had the opportunity to grow up with. And it was something that connected communities. It was something that children could grow up in, like I had done. And that's what really compelled us. And we had the opportunity, it was actually because of the Cultural Olympiad, so mm-hmm. that leading up to the Olympics in 2010, that we were able to start a festival, and we already had a fairly long-term partnership with the Museum of Anthropology at that time. And we began in a very similar way, where we connected with artists that where there was already some sort of connection, and we reached out, and And we started to develop relationships that have really strengthened over the years. And I see that not only in the community that surrounds the Coastal Dance Festival, but also in the development that I've seen in the artists. And I've seen, you know, very young dancers that have now grown up with the festival. And then also artists that have, you know, moved in a direction from where they started when they first came to a festival, where they've really drawn from one another's practice. And by that, like, we all have our own artistic expressions, and they're very diverse. But then there's also commonalities that are underlying. And I think those commonalities aren't specific to songs or specific to dances, but they're specific to a way of being. And I think that the festival reaches one another on that level, and we grow as a community from that. And that was really our vision for the festival. And it's primarily West Coast, but also artists nationally and internationally, Indigenous artists we've had the opportunity to have them as well, a part of the community.
Mm-hmm. It's definitely such a powerful, strong feeling that you get when you're involved in the festival, watching people perform and really just being in that space and feeling the ancestors and feeling the land, like, respond to the performances. It's this really amazing feeling. So I feel so lucky to have been able to experience a few seasons of it. So thanks.
Thank you.
And Mînowin, the world premiere, is here at the National Arts Center for Mushkamo Indigenous Arts Rising, the inaugural season of Indigenous Theatre at the National Arts Center. And we're so excited about that. Is there anything specifically about this creation process or something that is really exciting to the both of you about how this work came together that you want to share?
Well, Mînowin is definitely, in terms of a scales of work for our company, it exceeds what we've done by a lot. It's been a very ambitious project for us, especially in the time frame that we've worked on it. But I think that for me, what resonates most strongly for me with this project is that it is something that goes well beyond what we have been doing over the last several months. It's something that does begin with the process back in the 1960s, and it is something that looks at how we find ways to move forward. And I think that Mînowin translates to the act of clarifying direction. And for me, that was something that I was compelled to spend time with, because there has been so much loss. And it's not something that, even though I'm so grateful for the foundational work of my parents and my grandparents' generation, they had their own challenges. They had so many things that they had to do, and the work that they did came from such a place of love and vision and hope. They had to have hope that there would be dance again. And it feels like we somehow think that, well, they did that for us and now we are here in this good place. But then our generation has its own challenges, its own, we go through our own loss, and we can go through very epic loss at the same time. And I think that Mînowin is about looking at those places and looking from those places and seeing how what reemerge brings balance back. And in looking at that, it also made me look at that has been our whole history of dance. If you look at our oral history, which is in the Gitxsan called the Dauk, that has been the source of story going back to the beginning. It's when we come to these places of extreme imbalance or brokenness that we find a way to reemerge, and that becomes the story that we have to tell. And so I feel that as Indigenous people in this current day, you know, that is our story that we have to tell right now. And we each have to contribute to that, because it's too much to carry on any individual shoulders.
That's so beautiful and really hopeful. And I think bringing in conversations around balance and resurgence and moving forward together in a good way is so important and meaningful, and especially within all the work that's programmed here and being involved in the festival. It's just so exciting to be able to invite folks in to see this continuance of Indigenous cultural practices through dance. So I'm excited. Is there anything that you would like to say to listeners before they come to see the show or to think about while witnessing the performance?
I think that with anything, especially as an Indigenous artist, you want people to receive what you have to offer with a open heart. We all have individual stories that we're telling. What we're sharing is something that comes from the place that our family is at in this moment. And I think that collectively, we still struggle. Like there is a large gap there where we're navigating how to understand these stories of colonization, of trauma, of collective trauma, of dislocation, of disconnection to the past. And I think that it's not always easy to come into that space and not come into that space already carrying something. So I think, like, not just for Mînowin, but for anything that people are coming to see, is to just come in with that open heart and receive the gift that's being offered by the artists, by all the artists that have something to say, because I think that's the only way we're going to really find a way through reconciliation, is by being able to truly be ourselves and not be formulated.
Trying to fit a box or fit a preconceived idea of what Indigenous art is or what Indigenous identity is. People come from complex identities, and we are not just Gitxsan, we're not just Cree. You know, we have complex identities that involve other nations as well, and everyone is bringing those identities to Mînowin.
Excellent. I'm so excited. I can't wait to see the show. Thank you again both so much for coming and for chatting with me this morning. And folks can catch your show until September 28th. So I'm really looking forward to it. And thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
That's all for this NEC Dance podcast. Send us your comments and questions by email at necpodcasts@gmail.com. And don't forget, you can subscribe to NEC Podcasts at necpodcasts.ca. You can also find us as a free subscription in the podcast section of the iTunes Music Store. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Centre.
This has been a National Arts Centre podcast. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at necpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes Store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NEC podcasts at necpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Centre on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Centre.